Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for all that you've done through your Son. Help us not only to be thankful in this moment, Father, but to be mindful every moment so that we can fight the good fight of faith, so we can stand against the arrows that the enemy sends against us, so that we can be secure and rest in your goodness and your grace, so that we truly can walk free in this world. And we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Don't know why this locked up. There we go. Praise God. Well, today I want to talk about a problem. Now, maybe it's just a problem I have, but somehow I think it's not just a problem I have. Oh, I'm going to try and be good today and stay a little more in the center. Now, that's not my normal thing, but I'm giving the camera guys fits back there, moving back and forth. So I'll try and stand more in one place. So, and you know, I could be tempted to have guilt about that. And that's my topic today, guilt. What good is it? Well, you know, we all have those things, you know. It only takes a moment. You say a harsh word, you do a dumb thing, and then guilt hits you like a ton of bricks, and you feel sick. Because whatever you've said, you can't roll that back into your mouth, and whatever you've done, you can't undo it, and you feel sick. That weight of guilt comes crashing down on you, and the enemy says, see, you're no good, you're bum, you're awful, you're horrible. What do you mean you're a Christian? All these thoughts come in like a flood. And so, I'm trying to get full screen here. So what do you do with that guilt? Well, there's lots of different things we do. We try and go to the person that we've wronged and we apologize, and that's good. That's good, and maybe they even forgive us. That's great. But if you're like me, the guilt of that thing doesn't go away. I still feel like a crumb. I still feel awful. I sit sometimes and I think about things that happened when I was a kid, and I feel guilty about that stuff. And then I don't even feel guilty about the stuff I've done. I feel guilty about the stuff I haven't done. I didn't talk to this person. I didn't read enough of the Bible. I didn't pray hard enough. I didn't give enough in the offering. I mean, I could have guilt all day. And now I have guilt about guilt. It's a terrible thing. And when the world gets guilt, the world says, okay, I'll go to God. I'll go to a church and maybe they'll have an answer. And what do they do when they get to the church? They find the law. And now, not only did they disappoint themselves and their family, now they've disappointed God too. And they have more guilt. And it's just this vicious cycle. And so we try and do things, we try and give things, and it just goes on and on and on and on. And what's the cure for it? Well, there is a cure. Praise God. There's a cure. You know, guilt entered the world when Eve sinned. Really, it did. I know exactly what she did. She ate that fruit, and then she turned right around and wanted Adam to share in her guilt. And what is guilt anyway? You know, the Bible defines guilt as taking responsibility, being liable for. And of course, we know that Adam and Eve didn't take any responsibility for their actions. And so here we are, and we feel guilt. And, you know, it's all right to feel responsible for our mistakes and try and correct those things, but you know what? Feeling guilty about your sin, man, that is a problem that is too big for you to have responsibility for. Nothing you can do can pay for the magnitude of your sin nature. No matter what you do, or how long you do it, or how much you pay, you did not have the ability to remove that thing from yourself. And that's why Jesus came. That's why Jesus came. Because Jesus knew that guilt was a problem. See, guilt, once it came in with Adam and Eve, it just began to explode. You know? And mankind began doing all kinds of things, trying to put a band-aid on this pain in his heart. And he had no ability to do it. People did all kinds of crazy things. They sacrificed humans. They sacrificed children. They sacrificed grain and cows and sheep and all kinds of things, trying to cover up this pain of guilt. And none of it was able to remove that evil conscience. So, the good news is, our guilt, since it was caused by our sin, the remedy for guilt is the same remedy that there is for sin. The remedy for guilt is the cross. Hallelujah. The remedy for guilt is the cross. So what is guilt? Guilt is really your lack of knowledge or your lack of understanding of how complete the work of the cross was. That's all guilt is. Guilt is an area in your life. Here's an area where you do not trust the goodness of God. See, we know, we're Christians, I've said it already this morning, our sins are forgiven. You know, so we should not be walking in guilt at all. There is no such thing as godly guilt. Guilt does not come from God. Now God, when he does cause us, when the Holy Spirit speaks to us, he reproves the world of sin because they have not believed in him. But he speaks to the child of God of righteousness. So if you are feeling guilt, that message is not coming from God, because God does not say, you haven't done enough, you're not good enough, you're horrible, you're terrible, you're never going to do any good. That is not God's voice. God's voice says, you're my child. You are holy. You are righteous. You are loved. You are forgiven. Come here, give me a hug. That's what God's going to do. So if you are sitting there wallowing in guilt, that is lack of faith, really. Sin met its match in Jesus. I mean, Jesus literally became sin. It's not just he took sin, he literally became sin. He became my sin. He became your sin. He became the sin of the world. And it tells us that in 1 Corinthians 5:2, for our sake, 2 Corinthians 5:21, for our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. God took sin into his body, and he condemned it in the body of Christ. Romans 8, 3-4 says, for God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might both be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Sin met its match. Sin could not destroy Jesus. He rose. Hallelujah. See, The world looks at righteousness this way. The world says that righteousness is all about your actions. And even in the church, we look at our actions. And when we're doing really well, we feel really good and righteous. But then when we're having a rough day, when we're messing up, that's when the guilt comes in. And we forget who we are. We forget that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And even when our actions don't match the reality. You see, in the world, there are many, many, many atheists or agnostics who are wonderful people. They do wonderful things. They give, they're philanthropical. They sow money into the world. They give to the poor. They live holy lives. A lot of them are righteous in the world's eyes. You can't find a mark against them. They're kind. They're good. And yet, all of that goodness doesn't match the reality if they're an unbeliever. All of the goodness doesn't make them righteous. And as a believer, all of our badness doesn't match the reality. And the reality is this, that you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's why God tells us to put on the breastplate of righteousness. Put on His righteousness. It guards our heart. And that's where guilt hits us, doesn't it? Right to the heart. Ugh. Oh, it's a pain. It's always there. Man. Unrelenting. Weighing us down. Making us feel sick. And it's all because we're not considering who we are in Christ Jesus. We're not considering Jesus at all. See, the church for so long has told people, you know, well, if you sin, okay, here's what you have to do. Think about what you did. Feel bad about what you've done. You know, pray to God. Weep and cry and give some money. And if you do that long enough, maybe then, if you're really sincere, not just a little sorry, but really, really, really sorry, then God will wipe the slate clean and let you start over. And that's just not the way it is. That is not the way it is in a family. You know what? In my family, this is how it is. I would find out my sons had done something, right? And I would want them to come to me and confess. And they didn't always. I already knew what they had done. I'd already forgiven them for what they'd done. I was waiting for them to come to me to receive that forgiveness. You know? But the forgiveness was already done. And there's some value in confession. You know, it makes you feel good, but God doesn't need it. God doesn't need it from you. Because really, He's removed your sins as far as He has from you, as far as the east is from the west. And so your forgiveness is already in place. And when you come to God and you say, God, I'm so sorry for what I said to my husband. You know, He says, what? What? Because He doesn't remember these things. We waste so much time coming to God and asking Him to do what He's already done. You really don't need to ask God to forgive you. He already has. What you need to do is come to God and repent. And what I mean by that is say, Lord, I agree with You. I changed my mind. Yes, I agree with You that what I did was a bad thing. And I agree with You that even though I did the bad thing, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And thank You, Father, I do not have to walk in guilt over this thing. Your blood has taken care of it. The cross has taken care of it. Hallelujah. In Romans 3:21-26, God talks about this righteousness that we possess. It says, but now the righteousness of God has been manifest apart from the law. See, the world and the church for so many years has thought that righteousness equated with keeping the law, with obeying the commandments. That's where righteousness came from. God says that kind of righteousness is like filthy rags to him. And I won't go into detail on what kind of filthy rags, but believe me, they're filthy. That's what man's keeping of the laws and trying to toe the line and trying to give sacrifices, all that stuff is just so much trash as far as God's concerned. Here's the righteousness that God cares about. This righteousness that is apart from the law. Now, the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, this type of righteousness. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift. Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Your actions do not justify you. Your actions do not make you righteous. The righteousness of God is shown in that he has declared the sinner righteous. That's the showing. That shows God's righteousness. That shows God's mercy. That shows the goodness of God. That while we were yet sinners, he died for us. While we were yet sinners, he forgave us. And not just us, but the world. That is the righteousness of God. That is the God we love. That is the God who loves us. And the only way we can love him is if we recognize that he loves us. We love him because he first loved us. And that was shown at the cross. That's not the mere righteousness that comes from following a set of rules. This is the very righteousness of God. If I could see a picture of the righteousness in you, I would see a picture of Jesus. Because that is the righteousness that God has given you as a gift. Isn't that beautiful? It's a beautiful thing. But I still feel guilty. I still feel guilty. Here's the deal. Feelings lie. Feelings lie. You are not guilty. You are not responsible for the magnitude of your sin. Jesus took that responsibility into his body and he took it to the cross and he died that thing away. So, what do I do with the guilt? Hebrews 10:22 says, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. The blood of Jesus was not like the blood of a goat or a bull. The blood of a goat and a bull covered sin for a year until Yom Kippur came around, and the Israelites would once again bring their sacrifice, and then they could be clean for a year. And that sacrifice, there were sacrifices going on in the temple continually. The thing was 24/7. It was on. The priests were always sacrificing and praying and praising and repenting for the kingdom of Israel. It never stopped. It was a bloody religion, washed in blood and steeped in guilt. And that was never God's purpose. When God came to Adam and Eve and he killed the lamb and gave them clothes to wear, he wanted to remove their guilt. He didn't want them feeling horrible. That was supposed to be a place of connection. And of course, it pointed forward to Jesus. But that was supposed to ease their guilt. It was supposed to remove their guilt. Without blood, there was no forgiveness of sin. But blood was shed, so the sin was forgiven. But the sacrifices of blood of bulls and goats never could remove the guilt. It was always there. The sacrifice of Jesus, however, is better than the sacrifice of a bull or a goat. The sacrifice of Jesus was a one time for all. And one time for all, he made us perfect. And so we're supposed to walk in the perfection that Jesus bought. And if you are perfect, if you are righteous, if you are justified in Jesus Christ, there is no room for guilt. There's no room for guilt. Guilt is just the enemy's way of taking residence in your brain. Kick him out. Now, if you've done something wrong to somebody, apologize, for heaven's sakes. That's just polite. And if they don't forgive you, well, that's not on you. You know, if you can make a wrong, if you can fix a wrong with a person, then you're walking in love. And that's what we're called to do. But it has nothing to do with your righteousness. And you should not let guilt eat your lunch. It has no place with you. So, when guilt tries to come, when I'm starting to feel guilty about something I did when I was 12, oh, for heaven's sakes. And I know it happens to you too, it happens to me. When I start to feel guilty about an attitude I might have shown my husband, or a thought I might have thought about somebody. I mean, I get guilty about everything. I mean, I used to be the most guilt-ridden person you ever met. If the sun didn't shine, I was somehow responsible. I was a mess. Randy would tell you that. And he would tell you, Elaine has changed a lot since we met. You know, I felt guilty about everything. Every time I turned around, I was just guilt-ridden. I was trying so hard to please God. I was just so burdened down with guilt. I was taking responsibility for things I had nothing to do with. You know, that's a self-centered point of view. That's selfishness. You know, and I was a selfish person. I'll admit it. So, what do you need to do when that guilty thought comes? Take that thought captive. We're to take every thought captive, thanks, bud, to the obedience of Christ. Now, what does that mean? Taking every thought captive. When the enemy comes and says, you're a dirty, rotten crumb bum. You didn't pray long enough. You didn't read your Bible. You were out at the mall shopping and you could have been on your knees. That's just a lie. You know, you take every thought captive and you say, devil, yeah, I was at the mall and Jesus and I were having a great time and I found this really great dress and it was only 15 bucks. So, you know, I'm reminded of that comedian, you know, Cliff Wilson used to say, the devil would, you know, Geraldine, you know, and he would, the devil was saying, oh, you shouldn't spend that money, you shouldn't spend the money. And Geraldine said, Satan, get behind me. And the devil got behind her and said, yeah, it looks really good back here too, you know. You know, but I mean, the devil will try and make you feel guilty, but take those thoughts captive, because you need to remind the devil, no, devil, I'm not going to feel guilty about this. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And you can take your whiny, whiny little voice and go away. I don't have to listen to you. I will listen to the voice of my Father who loves me, who died for me and declared me innocent. Amen. Amen. Take every thought captive to the obedience of Jesus Christ. It's not your obedience that saves you. It's the obedience of Jesus Christ that saves you. That saved you and saves you. It continues. He continues to make intercession for you so that you don't get caught up in things. He continues to just love and defend you. The accuser may try and bring an accusation, and Jesus is our advocate before the Father, saying, no, this one's mine. This one's innocent. Let's open the records. See here? The page is blank. There's no record against this child. It's clean. Amen. That's what Jesus does for us. So, you know, when I was doing this study, I looked in my English Standard Version and I wanted to look up the word guilt and guilty. And in the Bible, in the version I was using, there's more of this if you're using Amplified. Guilt's a lot more. But in the English Standard Version, guilt was used 111 times. Six of those times was in the New Testament. And those six times were saying that there was no guilt found in this man who they were condemning to go to the cross. That's the only time guilt is used. And it is never used when it's talking about a believer. Guilt is an old covenant idea. And you are no longer in the old covenant. We are now in a better covenant with a better sacrifice and a better high priest, who has cleansed us forever and made us perfect in that high priest. Whoever lives to make intercession with the Father for us. We are part of a covenant that Jesus Christ made with his Father. I'm going to say that again. This covenant is not between you and God. This covenant is between Jesus and God. He is the mediator of a better covenant. And because Jesus is the mediator, he is the one that the covenant rests upon. So that's why God says to come to him. Got to go back to it. Back in 2 Corinthians, there it is. Nope, that's not the one. Colossians. Here's what I wanted to read. Colossians 2, 13 through 14. We have a hard time believing God is good. Here's what he says. This is in Phillips' translation, and it's really an awesome translation. Here's what it says in Colossians 2, 13 through 14. He has forgiven all your sins. Christ has utterly wiped out the damning evidence of broken laws and commandments which always hung over our heads, and has completely annulled it by nailing it over his own head on the cross. He took all the evidence that was against you, and he took it. So the question is not whether you broke a commandment or whether you broke the law. The question that stands before heaven's court today is this: did Jesus Christ raise from the dead? Yes, he did. And because Jesus Christ raised from the dead, that sacrifice that he brought into the Holy of Holies has been accepted as payment in full for mankind's sin. And it is a sure covenant that rests upon Jesus Christ. You know, it takes no faith at all to wallow in guilt. There's no faith in that. There's no faith at all in following the law. In fact, Galatians 3:11-12 says this about the law: "Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith. Rather, the one who does them shall live by them." Paul says that the law is not of faith. And if you would look through Hebrews 11, and we'll do that later as we're going through Hebrews on Wednesday night. If you'll look at the law, at Hebrews 11, which is God's list of the great heroes of faith, you will not find anybody in that list that came after the law was given. King David's not in there. You know, you don't have names of people who were under the law in that list of faith. The great men of faith were those who trusted in God because of God's grace. You see Abraham, you see Sarah, you see, I don't know all of them, I have to look at that, we'll study it out. But those people approached God and trusted in his goodness. And so when we feel guilt try and accuse us, we need to do what they did. We need to come to God and trust in his goodness. It doesn't take any faith to try and wallow in guilt. There's no faith in that at all. What takes lots of faith and is really difficult to do is to trust that God has forgiven you, and to trust that you are the righteousness of God, despite your actions. And to trust that God is not going to punish you. God is not in the punishing business. Does God correct us? Yes, he corrects us. But generally, he corrects us gently, and it's through his word or through other people. God doesn't make you sick to teach you anything. And God doesn't, you will never hear God say, "You dirty, rotten bum." No. God will say, "Child, what are you doing? What are you looking at? Stop looking at you. Set your eyes on me. Lift up your head. Lift it up. Your redemption draweth nigh." Look to him. Look to the cross. It's not about you. It's not about your action. It's all about what Jesus did. And you are in him. That's not just something that's going to happen after you die. You know, that's the only thing I would object to that song we sang, that first song, you know. It's not that we can have a life somewhere. I have this life now. We have eternal life now. God lives and dwells in us now. The very resources of heaven are available to us now because we are forgiven. There is nothing that can stop the Holy Spirit from working big in you. When you lay hands on the sick, trust that the Holy Spirit is going to do His work. It's not on you, it's all on Him. So have some freedom here. Don't moan and groan and say, oh man, that probably didn't work because I was mean to my husband. You know, I yelled at the kids, I kicked the dog. Oh, God will never use me. That is so much hogwash. And I know we do that. I know that we ask those questions. I know I did that when I was sick all those years ago. Man, that's the one thing. Oh, what do I have to do? What do I have to do? What did I do to deserve this? I cannot tell you how many times I've heard believers say that. Well, what did I ever do to deserve this? Nothing. Nobody deserves this. Especially now after the cross. None of us deserve it. The law has no right to rain down any of the curse on you. You have been redeemed from the curse of the law. Now we just get the blessings. Hallelujah. But the blessings don't come because of your obedience. The blessings come because of the obedience of Jesus Christ. We are more than conquerors. And what is a more than a conqueror? Well, I'll give you an earthly example. My mother was a stay-at-home mom. She didn't work outside the home. She didn't earn any money. My dad did all the work. He was out in the field. He brought in the harvest. He took care of the cattle. And when he sold those cattle, he got a paycheck, and my mom got the money. She was more than a conqueror. And that's the way it is with us. Jesus did all the work. And you get all the benefits. You are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. So we need to stop wallowing in guilt, which gets us nowhere. Just makes us self-centered and weak and beggarly. It's God hates it. God does not want you in guilt. God came to set you free from sin and the consequences of sin. He wants you free so that you can take His love and His message to the world. You are not going to go out to the world if you're wallowing in guilt. Guilt just makes you sit in the corner and weep and cry and look at yourself and, oh, woe is me. It's just a pity trip. It's a pity party. And nobody's going to come. God doesn't want you having pity parties. He wants you triumphant. He wants you looking at Him. He wants you to set your eyes at the cross and know that that's where your hope lies. That's where your victory lies. We are victorious because of what Jesus has done. So, once again, the law and your breaking of it is never the issue. The issue is always about Jesus Christ at the cross, your redemption bought. He rose from the dead, case dismissed. Hallelujah. That's where it's at. So, no longer let guilt take up residence in your mind, because this is the truth. You are His. You are righteous. You are holy. You are innocent. You are perfect in His sight. Stop looking at yourself. Stop looking at your circumstance. Stop listening to feelings that lie. Your feelings will come around if you will focus on Jesus. Your feelings will change, and you can say bye-bye to guilt. Now, is a guilty thought ever going to come? Yes. Sneaky little sniveling thing, they still come around. But don't let them take up residence. Don't let the bird make a nest in your hair. Tell guilt to go. It has to go. It isn't coming from God. It's not leading you to righteousness. It's faithless. And you are a person who walks not by sight, but by faith. And that faith is the faith of Jesus Christ living and dwelling in you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I never talk long. Hallelujah. But this morning, I do want to open up the altar. If anybody is struggling with this thing, if anybody is weighed down with burdens, God wants those things off of you. God does not want you hurt. God does not want you suffering about something that happened 30 years ago or something that happened this morning. God does not want those things weighing you down. If you are going to be effective in your life, you have to be able to run. You have to be free. Sin no longer has a hold on you. And if you wallow in guilt, you are allowing sin to hang on to you. And it has no right to do that. It has no right to do that. So do not look at the law. Do not look at your weakness. There is no power in that. Look at Jesus Christ. Look at what he has done. Look at his grace. That's where the power lies. So, if anyone wants prayer, come on up. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your life that dwells in me. That's a life guilt-free, a life of righteousness, holiness, innocence, purity, the very life of God. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that you have made us partakers of the divine nature. You are a miracle-working God. And Father, as those thoughts of guilt come into our mind, help us, Father, to instantly stop it. Help us to put up the shield of faith and say, no, I am healed. My sins are forgiven. I am perfect in Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.